If you have an encounter that you'd like to hear narrated on this channel, send me an email with your entire story to contact@BuckeyeBigfoot.com. Whoa, dude, don't scare me like that. I didn't know you were standing right there. I mean, wait, how did you, you're a stinky, smelly Sasquatch. I can usually smell you a football field away. How on earth did you sneak up on me and... Oh my gosh, you smell good. You went and got yourself some Yeti bars, didn't you? Come on, tell me the truth. Is that... That is, that's the glacier scent on your fur. Wow, you smell good. I'm telling you, folks, if you want to smell as good as a freshly scrubbed Sasquatch, get yourself on over to YetiBars.net and use code BB10 to get 10% off your order. Welcome back to Buckeye Bigfoot. Hello there, everyone. Well, we've got a fairly long story for you tonight, so I suggest you make sure you have plenty of snackage and drink at your fingertips. Now, we're only going to make one stop tonight as we head down into Sasquatch Valley, but this place is well known for sightings and other things with strange and elusive beasts that tend to roam the lands there. No, I'm not talking about the Pacific Northwest and not even here in Ohio. I'm talking about Missouri, of course. So go on, grab your baby carrots, your celery sticks, your chicken wings, or whatever you got for your satisfying snackage tonight. Because it's time we get saddled up and time to start moving out on the trail. And I'm telling you, tonight's going to be a doozy, I think. Let's go. Hello, Nance. A friend of mine convinced me to put my story to paper and to send it in to you. So here it goes. Fair warning, I'm not a writer, and I'm counting on this word program to help fix all my mistakes, of which I am sure there will be plenty. I guess the best place to start would be at the beginning of the events, but I think I need to add some earlier things into the story first to put later events into focus. My name is Tammy, and in 1976, I was 10 years old, and I had to go live with an aunt and uncle due to some painful life events, which I just can't bring to mind anymore without falling apart. They lived on a little farm in south central Missouri. It was a typical farm. They had a few horses, some cows, chickens, pigs, and a nice-sized field for soybeans. The house itself had the look of being made by someone that didn't build houses, or maybe they had a bent yardstick, or maybe they only had a 9-inch ruler. You know, a typical farm. My first week there was pretty much eat, play, ride a horse, and have fun settling in. Then I was told how farm life really worked. And I do mean worked. I was given a list of daily chores that had to be done at specific times, and a list of rules that had to be followed 100% to the letter, with no questions. At first, I was rebellious. But after a few rear-end warmings, I decided to fall in line and do the work, which would have to be reduced with the school year about to start. My first odd occurrence happened in early November. I was checking all the gates to make sure they were locked and that all the chickens were in the coop. That's when I got this real creepy feeling. I looked around toward the tree line, where I saw two big eyes reflecting in the dark, which I thought was just another black bear. They were not real common in the area, but they had been seen from time to time. After all was done, I went inside to eat. But all throughout dinner, my eyes kept being drawn to the kitchen window. There was nothing there, but I just couldn't stop looking at it, which made my aunt ask, "What was I looking at?" I said, "I saw a bear in the tree line when I was out checking on the chickens." The room got so quiet, you could have heard a pin drop. I saw the look of total fear on my aunt's face as she stared at my uncle. The look on his face was completely emotionless, as if he was solid stone. I asked, "What was wrong?" But my uncle only said, From now on, you're inside 1 hour before sunset, and all the windows and the doors are to be locked and the curtains closed. Then he said, you are not to look outside after dark, period. Got me? I said, it's just a little black bear. They're like big furry chickens. He just gave me that same look of stone, and then he said, you're done with dinner. Go upstairs and do your homework. Then get your bath and get to bed. No questions. So I did my homework, and I went to bed. But I could not get to sleep, not with the dinner events running through my mind. I don't know what time it was, but I was awakened by the sound of cows, horses, pigs, and chickens all having a major fit. Then I heard my uncle yelling, get out of here, you dirty SOBs! Then I heard gunfire going off. I went to my window and I looked out into the dark. I could see the outline of my uncle facing the tree line. When he turned to come back into the house, he saw me in the window, and he started to walk faster. I flew back to bed, and I pretended to be sleeping. He came into my room and said, first and last warning, do not look outside at night. Then he went back to his and my aunt's room. The next morning, when I was getting ready for school, I heard my uncle come into the house and tell my aunt that one of those dirty SOBs had ripped open the side of the chicken coop and killed and took some of the chickens. I walked into the kitchen for breakfast before I had to catch the bus for school. I asked, was everything okay? To which my aunt replied, everything was fine, and that the bear tried to get a chicken dinner last night, but that it was gone now. After the events of last night, I decided to just drop the issue. I didn't want my uncle to get angrier at me. At school, I told a few of the other kids that a bear had come in the night to get our chickens, and they just had very puzzled looks on their faces, and one boy said, you dumb girl, bears are in their dens, sleeping for the winter. The only thing I could say was, well, this one wasn't. And you're an in-town boy. You don't know anything about the woods. Later on that evening, I did my usual chores, and I was in the house before dark. I ate dinner, I did my homework, and then went to bed. And just like the night before, all the animals got riled up, and my uncle yelled and shot his shotgun out into the dark. Then he cursed at the dirty SOBs. This sort of thing would happen once, maybe twice a week, all the way until about March. Then it all just stopped. In May of 1977, life events turned another page for me, and I was able to move back to be home with my mother, who was back on her feet and doing much better. I left the farm life behind me and went on with life. In 2005, I was a single mother of two, but both of my children had already set out on their own. I lived a quiet, uneventful life in the city with a big fur baby that I named Simba. Simba was a big, spoiled house cat, or rather, big, spoiled apartment cat. I then got a call from the town doctor where my uncle lived. He told me that my uncle was in the hospital and that he was asking for me. I started to feel bad about not really keeping in touch over the years, but we didn't ever really seem to have a connection. My aunt had died 10 years earlier, and I thought my uncle considered me a burden anyway. He passed away the night before I was set to arrive. At the hospital, I was met by a gentleman that was my late aunt and uncle's lawyer. He stated that they had left the farm and all assets to me as their only living relative. I said, what am I going to do with a farm? I can't run a farm. The gentleman said to me, go look at it. Then give me a call when you decide what to do, and I will help you figure it all out. The next morning, I drove out to the farm, and I found that it had really changed. The only livestock was one milking cow and about a dozen chickens. The soybean field was now a field of weeds. The barn looked like it should be condemned. And the surrounding woods had made a significant advance on the house. But the property as a whole? Well, it had its possibilities. So I planned on staying there. I moved myself and my furry cat companion Simba in, and I began to fix the place up. I realized right away it was pretty rough, and it never occurred to me that Simba had never been outside unprotected. Simba had a screened-in balcony to go out on back in the city, so until I could figure something out for him, Simba would just have to settle for sitting in a window. I got fully moved in about mid-June and started working on the place. After a few months, I had all the high grass and the weeds cut back to the tree line, and all the junk had either been hauled off or put in the barn. Simba now had a screened-in enclosure that was built onto the side of the house connecting to one of the windows. Yes, I know how crazy that sounds, but I wanted Simba to be safe and to be able to be outside. Everything was going pretty close to what I had planned. Then I found my uncle's journal, and it all changed. Page 1 started with this. Tammy, I had hoped to tell you these things in person, but since you're reading this, I guess I didn't get the chance. Years ago, when you were staying here, I know I was rough on you, but I was doing it for your protection. I didn't want you to see what me and your aunt were dealing with, but now you're old enough to know. We don't know what these things are, but they've been here since before my father was born. My forefathers built this farm, and they raised their families here, with these things around, over 200 years ago. And according to my father, they were called boogers. But he called them SOBs because they would take things and kill the livestock. The night when you said you saw a bear in the woods, I knew that they were back again. It seems like they aren't always here. We only heard them around the winter time. The past 3 years have been relatively quiet. I've only heard them outside a few times, and they stopped killing the livestock. But I still don't trust those things. My uncle's journal had entries going back 10 years to right after my aunt died. Most of the entries were very similar, but some stood out from the others, like these. November 15th, 1997. One of those darn things ripped the barn door off and threw it on top of the barn. November 20th, 1998. I found the windmill tipped over again. December 1st, 1998. Now they're banging on the house and making all sorts of crazy sounds. December 23rd, 1998. They ate the wreath that was on the front door. January 11th, 1999. Spent the night in town due to the snowstorm. Came back home, found the kitchen door pushed in, and a single pine cone lying on the floor. Nothing else is wrong in the house. If they try to do this when I am home, there's going to be a hairy beast with a pound of buckshot in its rear end. After taking it all in, I decided to make some changes that may make the farm less desirable for them. Step 1, get rid of all the livestock. Step 2, I added motion sensor lights to all sides. Step 3, I had the wood line thinned out. Winter came and went without any sign of any unwanted visitors, so I figured they must have found someplace better to be. 2009. I've almost completely remolded the farm into a nice, up-to-date rural house, with a nice deck and above-ground pool in back. And still, no unwanted guests of the hairy kind. But so it begins. I was sitting at my desk reading and responding to some emails. My desk is in the corner of the room. The office door is to the left, and there's a window on the right side, so I get a nice breeze. This is also the window that my cat's enclosure is attached to. At one point, I hear my Simba hissing, and as I moved the curtain over to see what he was sounding off about, he came in and ran out of the room. He's done this before when he saw a stray dog and even over a deer one time, so I didn't think much of it. About 10 minutes pass, and I have to go get a drink. I came back to my desk, and I hear a scratching sound on the screen of the cat patio. I said in a stern voice, "Simba, stop scratching on the darn screen." And then a very deep voice replied back to me, Simba. I just stood there. I couldn't move or make a sound. Then the voice said, "Simba," again. And it started to scratch on the screen once more. This snapped me out of it. I grabbed my uncle's shotgun. I pumped one round into it. Whatever was outside must have heard this, because it made a grunting kind of sound and then ran off. I could hear its footfalls as it fled. I searched for, and I found Simba hiding underneath my bed. He was okay, just scared. I couldn't get him to come out, so after making sure the doors were locked and the windows were closed, I stayed in the room with him for the rest of the night. But the event kept playing over and over in my mind, and I realized it wasn't even winter yet. It was barely September. The next day, I went outside to look around, and I found what may have been a footprint, but it was not clear enough for me to see for sure. I checked the motion sensor lights and found that the one on the office side of the house had mud, dirt, or other covering it, so I washed it off with the hose. I checked Simba's enclosure, and it was easy to see that a set of claw or nail marks going from the top down to about the middle of it. That enclosure is 7 feet high, 5 feet wide, and 3 feet deep, with multiple platforms for Simba to walk or climb on. It's a wooden frame made of 2x4s with chicken wire around the frame so Simba can't claw his way out, and a screen mesh on the outside to keep debris from getting in. The next few days were uneventful, but I was not going to let my guard down. I went into town the next day, and I bought some personal protection for just in case things really go south, and I arranged to have an alarm system installed. A couple months have passed since that night in my office. The only thing happening is the occasional motion sensor light coming on, followed by a grunt or two. Then it leaves. December 2009. Terror at first sight. I was watching some Christmas movies, and I fell asleep on my couch, which was right by the sliding glass door that leads out to my deck. I woke up to the motion sensor light coming on, and the light was hitting me in the face. Without really thinking about it, I knew that it was on a 1 minute timer and it would go back off. But it went off in only a few seconds. I opened my eyes and I looked up at the door, and I saw that the light hadn't gone off. It was being blocked by the biggest, hairiest, meanest looking thing I have ever seen. It stared down at me, and it gave me the most evil grin, causing me to fly right off the couch, tripped over the coffee table, and smacking my head into the wall. I fell down onto the floor, and I looked back at it, expecting that it would be coming through the door to get me. But it just stood there, looking at me. Then the evil grin changed into something of a smirk. It turned and walked away, making sounds that to me sounded like it was laughing. He was laughing at me. That dirty, hairy beast was laughing at me. For the rest of December, I would go out onto my deck with the shotgun a few times each day to show this thing that I was armed, and he better leave me alone, which I am sure everyone is guessing didn't work. Well, You'd be correct. That big hairy jerk did back off some, but not completely. Over the next few months, I noticed the motion sensor lights would either get covered by debris or pointed down lower so they wouldn't activate. So, if this jerk was so intent on messing with me, I was going to mess right back with him. I would randomly adjust the sensor lights or overlap them with each other so that thing wouldn't know how close to the house it could get. Next, I thought since this thing only came out to mess with me at night, it had to have very light-sensitive vision. So I randomly placed remote-activated strobe lights at the windows, set at 2-second intervals, so its vision couldn't get adjusted to the light. Time went on, with the occasional light activation, then a grunt or a growl. In return, I would open the door on that side of the house, and I would give it a nice big laugh of my own. One night, I had sensor lights on both sides of the house come on at just about the same time. I thought, okay, this is new. I hit the remote for the strobe light on the side that isn't normally approached from, and the screams and the shrieks that erupted from the night were inhuman. I looked out the window, and I saw a different hairy booger. So, I thought, he has a friend that also wants to play. After this encounter, I thought I would try to make peace with the hairy jerk and his friend before it got worse. So I cooked outside on the grill one night, and once I heard them stirring out there in the dark, I casually got some hot dogs and a big chunk of steak off the grill, and I took them over and placed them on a stump. I said out loud to them, "Here, have some food. We can be friends, and we can leave each other alone." I don't know if they understood me or not, but maybe they might recognize the gesture of it. I turned off the sensor lights on that side of the house and sat in the living room. I acted like I was watching television, but I had my .44 under the blanket with me. At one point, I could hear one of the duo on that side of the house with the lights off. They were walking around. I yelled out, "Did you like your dinner, friend? It's not going to be an every night thing, though. As long as you're nice to me, I will be nice to you." The rest of the year was uneventful. The one that I called the jerk, he would only give me a few taps on the side of the house when he was around, just to let me know he stopped by. But the other one, he still liked to mess with me. He would watch me from the tree line when I was outside, and he would toss pine cones at me or scream at me to make me jump. Then he would run off laughing like the jerk used to do. 2010. Over time, Simba had become more adventurous and had wanted to go all the way outside, but only when he was sure that there were no nasty things around. But I was not going to risk Simba getting lost or hurt. So I got a cat harness, and I got him acclimated to wearing it. I would put his harness on him, and we would step out onto the deck for a bit for him to give everything a good sniffing. Then we would sit on the glider for a little while. He would usually want to go back inside within 10 minutes. One day, he wanted to go investigate the grass, so we walked down the steps and out into the yard. He did his usual sniffing investigation. Then he froze in place, and he began to stare at a patch of trees to my left. I knew then one of the duo had to be close by, so I bent down to pick him up and to go back inside. But as I bent down, I caught movement to my right, and I saw it was the jerk. He was looking towards me with a severely angry look. As I stood up to turn to go back inside, I was struck from behind in the head. I woke up some time later sitting on the glider without Simba. I stumbled to my feet and began to call him, but he did not respond. I collapsed to the ground, and I began to cry and yell out, "You killed my Simba! You killed him, you beasts! Why?" anguish turned into rage, and I ran into the house. I grabbed the shotgun and the box of shells, and I went back outside, circling the house, looking for anything big and hairy to put a load of buckshot into. When I got to the spot where I had been hit from behind, I found a big chunk of a tree limb. I noticed that the area where Simba had been focused on, well, it looked like a war zone. One tree was pushed over, and tree limbs were busted up, and there was a fair amount of blood, but way too much to be from a cat. I continued my walk around the property. I saw that Simba's outdoor enclosure had been broke open. It looked like the top corner had been torn open, then bent, and pushed forward back in. I was crying out for Simba, and from inside the room that connected to the enclosure, I heard Simba meow for me. I ran back inside, and I found Simba under the desk. Simba was alive, but he wouldn't come out from under the desk, so I crawled underneath there to be with him as much as I could, and I held Simba the rest of the night. The next morning, I carried him out from under the desk and into the kitchen so I could feed him and check him better. He had no visible injuries, but he was very filthy and he smelled terrible. So after feeding him a lot of attention and some cat treats, I gave him a bath, which got him clean, but he still had some of that smell on him. To make this part short, I bathed him every day for the whole week and finally got rid of most of the smell. I looked back at the previous day's event and began to wonder, did the jerk see the other one? Was he giving him the dirty look instead of me? And the area where the other one was, it looked like a war zone, so could the jerk have attacked him for hitting me with a chunk of wood? Did the jerk put me on the deck and then find, catch, and put Simba back in the enclosure? It all made sense, but would he do that? Did he do that? 2 nights go by without hearing or seeing any signs of either of them. So I decided to have a nice barbecue, which would always get some attention. I placed a plate with a few hot dogs, some burger patties, and a big ear of buttery corn in the usual spot on the stump. Then I sat by the barbecue pit and I ate my food. After 20 to 30 minutes, I heard some movement in the tree line, but this time I was not going to go inside right away. I wanted to know which one was still around, and if it wasn't the jerk, but the other one, I had something special for him in my jacket, a .44 mag loaded with hollow points. I sat and I watched the bushes. I talked softly. I said, "It's okay. You can come out and get some food. And if you're the one that hit me in the head, I'm going to put some lead in your hairy face." From the trees, I heard the same voice that had said Simba to me the one night. The voice said, "Friend, good. Simba, good." I replied, "Yes, I am good. Simba is good. Are you good?" It replied, "Good." I walked back to the house and stood in the doorway. I turned around to see him standing by the stump, devouring the food. He looked up at me. Instead of smirking and walking back into the woods, he just stood there, looking at me and eating. And when he was done, he let out an enormous burp, then walked back into the darkness of the trees. Over the rest of the year, I would hear him outside my house, walking around and being nosy. I would leave things outside for him to check out. Some things would go over well, while other things were less popular. I placed an old trunk with some fish patties in it, just to see if he could figure out how to open it, which he did by smashing the top in. And he would leave things for me, like a truck tire in my pool, to go along with the inner tube that was floating in it. In 2011, it all changed. A large investment company came to town and started to buy up large sections of land, including just about all of the land that surrounded mine. They cleared almost all the wild forest areas, and by the end of the year, there wasn't even enough land that was fit for a single deer to live on, and instead of old country roads, it was now two-lane roads and a highway. In late 2014, Simba passed, and I was alone in the house. There was no longer the occasional hairy visitor tapping on the house just to say, "Hi, I'm here." And the upkeep on that property was getting to be just too much work. So I caved in. I sold it to that investment company, and I moved into a little house in town, and I adopted two new kittens. I named one Simba Jr. and the other Harry Jerk Jr. 2022. I made friends with someone who had just moved in next door, and while sitting on my couch, both of my cats decided to introduce themselves. After telling him the cats' names, he had to comment how interesting the names were, so I felt inclined to tell him the origins of the names, which led me to writing this all down for you. He said that he has seen three of them years ago on a fishing trip, and that I should listen to your show on YouTube, which I now do. Now, I left a lot of things out, but they're not what I consider a key event in the story, like them smearing what I hope was just really smelly mud on my car, or turning over the lawn furniture. Signed, sincerely, Tammy G. Wow, my SAS squad, now that was an incredible story. I'll put that up there on probably the top 10 of any I've ever received. Thank you, Tammy, for sending that in. It's just incredible that your aunt and uncle had these creatures there since before you were even there, and that you got to, I guess, kind of semi-see one as a child, and that your uncle not only left you the farm, but he wrote all of that down for you in a journal. I mean, that's just one in a million. I mean, thanks again for sending this in. I really enjoyed it. And a lot of the things you mentioned at the end that probably weren't key to the story, I don't know. A lot of people like a lot of those extra details because it gives us a little bit of insight into their behavior and what they do other than the big scary moments, you know. I mean, smearing stuff, positioning the lights, I think those are all important. All right. Thanks again. I really appreciate it. Now, real quick, I do want to remind everyone that the live stream, the question and answer for the 50,000 subscribers is happening this coming Sunday, April 3rd. It's going to start at 8 p.m. Eastern Time. That's 7 Central, 6 Mountain, 5 Pacific Time. And just bear with me if this live stream doesn't go smoothly. I've never done a live stream myself. I've never ran one, started one, whatever. So it might not be the smoothest thing ever. Who knows? I don't know. We'll figure it out together, though. I'm looking forward to it. All right. Well, I think that is going to do it for tonight. Until we meet up again, I need you to always remember, absence of proof is not proof of absence. Thanks for listening, everyone.